Paul.
All right. Thanks. It's almost as important as President Bush. Okay, you want to?
That's why. That's why. There we go. Try it.
For the new people here tonight, I'm going to try to simplify the lecture a little bit for you so you can catch with everybody else. The lecture tonight is all about the brain inside and out. Basically, if you notice I don't have the flyer for the lecture, but what I remember from my office, it was hanging around there. It says headaches, I think, is one of them, and multiple sclerosis is another one. Tension headache, I think, is one of them. Stress. I prepared that lecture from my board of holistic medicine. So whatever information we give you tonight is being practiced by 200 American Board of Holistic Medicine physicians around the country, just like me. So we selected to talk about multiple sclerosis because lots of people have it. Lots of women have it, some men have it, and they're not getting any hope. And then we have achieved excellent results in our office for the last 28 years with multiple sclerosis. So we want to share some of that with you today. Most of the lecture is going to be concentrating on nutrition. We're not going to explain the disease itself very much. But we're going to talk about the role of nutrition in it. And also, we're going to include, being holistic medicine doctor versus nutrition doctor, now we have to include other things that's important, such manual therapy, aromatherapy, massage. All of these things have roles. Also, chiropractic therapy, all of those have roles in management of the disease. The lecture is basically we want to see what causes. We're going to start first with the brain itself as an organ. Why do we have so many problems with it, such as headaches? I'm not going to ask how many people have headaches here, because if I ask the question how many people did not have any headache, and somebody did not raise their hand, then I'm going to tell them, did you take your acuity, you know? Because everybody gets a headache, you know? And if we want to study the brain, we have to look at the skull itself as a structure like that, and the socket of the eye right here, and the mouth will be right here, and the jaw will come like that. This will be the skull. Is this clear in front of everybody there? Okay. And it's connected, of course, to the vertebral column underneath it. And inside the skull, we have the brain that sits inside it in here like that. And it comes through the spinal column down like this. And through the opening right here, nerves come out. And they do different things inside the body. And inside the brain, of course, there are 200 billion cells that they do the function of the brain, and they all outside of the brain. None of them is inside the brain. They sit outside of the brain, and each one of them connect to wire like this, comes down, and the 200 billion cells, each one of them have about 10,000 cells to serve it. Each cell of the 200 billion have 10,000 cells to serve it all your life. They sit around it, watching it, and if they find something is wrong, they go to fight for you right away. So it's very difficult to accept the fact that we have Alzheimer and we're going to live with it. No, yes, we can reverse it. We have done it in our office. It is very difficult to accept, I have MS, and my doctor told me, go home and just that's the end of your life. It's not true. You cannot take the hope away from people, number one. Number two, as a nutrition doctor and internist, I have seen good results. We might not have seen cure and everything, but we have seen quality of life has improved. So these cells right here, they require blood supply that comes from the heart, and it goes inside the brain in three arteries, one to the front, one in the middle, and one to the back. And any problem in those arteries, it will give us problems with the brain. The only way the brain can communicate with you is give you pain, or give you numbness, or give you headache, or give you blurred vision, or incoordination. There is no other way the brain can let you know something wrong unless it does that. These kind of symptoms, we're going to go over it tonight. Is it a multiple sclerosis beginning of it? Is it some kind of a migraine headaches? Is it some kind of tension headache? And also, if we have the time, we will cover attention deficit disorder also, that what nutrition should we do with that, and that's part of the brain problem also, because we can help lots of kids with ADD and ADHD also through nutrition. But it depends on the time, because I'm going to make things simple, but we're going to go forward, and if you interrupt me, that's fine, you can, but I like you to keep your question to the end. Outside of the brain, then, we have other organs sits outside, and those organs are the scalp itself, right here, which there's a muscle underneath that, hooked to the front right here, to the neck and the back right here. This muscle hook from here all the way to the back, it make you move your head back and forth and all of that. In the meantime, if that muscle gets sore, then it gives us something we call tension headache. We will also talk about that. Outside here we have the eye, that any problem with it also can give us some problem with the vision or headache. We have also TMJ right here. If there's a problem with root canal or sinus infection, also can affect. So we can divide the lecture to two things, inside and outside the brain. We will start with inside the brain, because outside of the brain doesn't kill you. Inside, well. We already talked about the anatomy of the brain. Let me magnify the brain a little bit in the picture and show you. I just want to get rid of some of this transparencies here and get the thick one that I can use. Okay, if we look at the anatomy of the brain, we'll find that the brain is made from several sections, and each section specializes in something. We find that the frontal lobe right here area specializes in thinking and making sense and solving problems, and that's the part right here gets involved with this part here with memory loss and dementia and things like that. And the middle part right here of the brain is involved with moving object and feeling cold or heat, and if you lose the ability to move your hand or arm, that is very depressing. That's called paralysis, and that is not acceptable to all, most of us. The sensory part also just as bad. If you lose the sensation that you don't have the touch, or you lose some of those sensation you have, that also become very depressing, and that is something we will cover through the lecture. The back of the brain right here specializes in balance, to keep you balanced on your feet, and also vision. They make you like a mirror in the back, like a TV screen right here. Whatever you see, it gets upside down in the back right here. That's why when you hit somebody in the head, they see lights, and I suggest not to do that. Okay, and then with all these activities the brain does every second, from vision, hearing, all of this knowledge you put through over the years, everything gets stored right here in the parietal lobe right here in layers, and all the memories you had when you were inside your mother womb or when you heard her voice is still there. And then all the stuff, even if you have dementia, everything goes in, stays there. It doesn't come out. This is why we say with Alzheimer, it can be reversed, and it will be reversed eventually, because we know it has some relation to certain things that we do to ourselves. I will go ahead and put some of the slides I want to talk about. Here, I put the slide in the beginning to show you the word when the body attack itself. Actually, if you look at Alzheimer and fibromyalgia, tension headache, migraine headaches, imbalance, and all of this is related to autoimmune diseases, that the immune system itself is attacking the brain itself. Are you following me so far? Okay. When you're ready to fall to sleep, tell me, I'll tell you a couple jokes, then you wake up, okay? All right. So this problem is a serious problem. This way, we have to understand how does the body work. The body works that every cell, every brain cell, like this, it has the head and the tail. And the head, that's in the brain, the 200 billion we talked about. You remember that? And the tail is what carries it all the way to your arm, your leg, your hand, your heart, your any place. Well, if you take 200 billion wires and put them through a hole in the skull, no bigger than this pin right here, that, you know that the creator, who's God, even if you are atheist, you have to believe in that. At least for tonight, you have to believe in that. That is a miracle to put 200 billion wires through a tiny hole, and they're all electric, and they do not touch each other. Isn't it amazing? They don't touch each other. 200 billion wires right here, and how many times we have car accidents, we have any time we fall, we do this, we do that, and they're all well protected, and we are just like we live in a world that we've been observed and protected by the creator of us all the time. Now, this insulation material, this insulates that those nerve, it's called the myelin sheath. And the myelin sheath is made of a substance called lecithin. So if you heard about lecithin, which is a supplement, it's very important for the myelin sheath. So regardless if you have a migraine or MS or ADHD or ADD or even cerebral palsy or stroke, whatever, you need to make more myelin sheath. Another thing I want to tell you, nerves grow. When they die, they can grow back. That's another thing, many people don't know that. You see somebody who had a stroke, and after about a year, they can walk, they can speak. So there is a reversal of brain disorder. This head right here does all the function, does all the thinking of the brain, all the function inside that head. And that's why most of the nutrients go to that area right here, and the brain is amazing organ of taking nutrients. It consumes 70% of the sugar you eat every day within the reason. 70% of the sugar you eat every day consumed by the brain, and the 30% consumed by the rest of the muscle in the body. Why? Because the brain is like a furnace. It's working all the time, breathing, the heart, the thinking, you name it. You know, even when you're sitting right here, I'm standing right here. What makes me stand on 2 feet, I'm not going like this, it's the brain. The brain with the eyes watching where I am and keep everything in order. When that goes bad, then we have Parkinson's disease and we have shaky hand, we have all of that, which we also can correct. The myelin sheath right now, then when it goes away and your cells touch each other, then we have seizures, or we could have what we call multiple sclerosis. So we're going to start right away with putting some of the... this is my handwriting, so I can read it sometimes, but believe it, I wrote that when I was on the plane, so if you cannot read it, it's the air doing it, not me. Okay. Basically, we're talking about tension headache. I'm sure you know what tension headache is. When you feel soreness in the neck and the head right here, is anybody here have not have a tension headache in their life? We all get tension headache. And then we go like this, massage it, or take a shower, or take a nap, or go to a chiropractor or something. So tension headache is really terrible thing to have. Because any pain to the body, it sucks the energy out of the body. All kind of pain, any kind of pain sucks your energy out. And the brain have no mercy when there is something wrong, little thing as pinprick in your hand or a massive heart attack, the brain read it the same way. Something is dangerous. So you put your hand on a hot plate, you feel that severe pain. You have a massive heart attack, you have severe pain. The brain doesn't know, you know, how bad things are around you, so it tells you at a maximum fire. You know, tension headache is caused by when the muscle in the front here to the back get tense and the body is attacking itself. It is from fibromyalgia. It is the entrapment of substance P as in Paul, inside the muscle that causes the tension headache. It can be caused by many things. Of course, you know, you don't need more explanation on it. There's 45 million people go to the doctors for tension headache every year. It can be caused by stress. It can be poor attitude. Sometimes the person is not positive. It can be caused by lack of sleep. Like you don't get a good night of sleep, then the muscles get tense, because in a sleep you relax basically, and if you're not relaxed all night and tense, you grind your teeth. Of course, you're gonna have muscle spasm and things like that. It can be caused by chronic fatigue syndrome, also lack of exercise. If you have any muscle in the body that doesn't exercise, it will get stiff. It will get filled with free radicals. It gets so, I know you heard my lectures in the past about the heart. It gets full of free radical to the point it gets so stiff that muscles, let me just find a piece of paper to show you what it will, rather than being elastic, the muscle like that, it becomes stiff that when suddenly you move, you can sprain it. You can break it, or if it is in the heart, it can break like this. We call that myocardial infarction. So eye strain also can contribute to tension headache. And root canal, TMJ, cervical disc disease, right back here also, if they pinch the nerve, that can cause tension headache. Thyroid, lots of people have low thyroid and they don't know it. Low thyroid means low energy. Problem with hair, problem with skin, problem with weight. We're going to be talking about that in the next lecture. Decrease of adrenal gland function also can lead to tension headache. Also having hormonal problem. Women have a lot more hormones than men, and they tend to have more problems from those hormones if the environment around them is not right. We will talk about that in a minute when we talk about migraine headache and circulation. Men also don't get as much migraine as women, but they do get tension headache a lot also because they always tense. Alcohol can bring it on. Aspartame can bring it on. And also solvents, like if you work with diesel fuel or fumes from gasoline, can also bring tension headache on. pollution can bring it on, air or water or food, and anxiety can bring it on. So I already, in a few minutes, cover symptoms. That's all I did. But my goal of the lecture is to go to the next part, which is the nutrition part. The nutrition part right here, I'm not sure if you can see this or not on the screen. Maybe it will show on the, you know, if and the DVD will show, right? No problem, okay. We got the master right here, so we don't have to worry. Now, nutrition-wise, believe it or not, having taken B-complex, it does relax the muscle for tension headache. Calcium, how much B-complex you would take a day if you have tension headache? You probably, when you have the tension headache, you probably need about 2-3 times a day. And when you're taking your supplement, when you have headaches or migraine or any of the things we're going to talk about today, tonight, it's always 3 times a day. It's never once a day. Even if you have to take 1-3 times a day, it's better than 20 once a day. You follow me or no? So be careful that the nutrition is your friend, but take it appropriately. The calcium, which is the number 2 right here, is also important. For women, they need lots of calcium. Most of the time, you have to take the calcium with vitamin D with it, because vitamin D is anti-stress vitamin. Vitamin D, they call the sunshine vitamin, because in the winter, when we get winter right here, like last night when you are 9 degrees from freezing, and they say tonight's going to be 7 degrees from freezing in my area, that's depressing, you know. So what happened, rather than go to Las Vegas, Nevada, all that, you just will take 2 vitamin calcium with vitamin D 3 times a day. That extra vitamin D will give the brain the feeling the sunshine is over there. You know, because the Eskimos survive those things, they don't go to doctor, they don't complain, because they consume lots of meat which has lots of vitamin D from the seals. The magnesium also is very important. You get that in Vital Mag. And how much of that will do? If you can take Vital Mag for tension headache without having diarrhea from the magnesium, then you start with 1 magnesium and Vital Mag twice a day first, then increase it to 1-3 times a day, see how your bowel going to take the magnesium, and then if it takes it, increase it to 4 a day. I don't think you need more than that. The next one is potassium. Potassium, you get that from eating bananas and eating things that has potassium in it. Is very, very important, and 99% of you right here deficiency of potassium and magnesium. I tell you that right now. Because the amount, doesn't matter how much you take, your intestine not gonna tolerate as much, you still can put more potassium and you feel better when you do that. So pay attention to the potassium, and also it's relaxant, the heart loves it, the brain loves it, the muscle loves it, and it is excellent for feelings, you know, if you have coordination, if you have like that, all this is the potassium pump does that. Manganese also, which you get that from alfalfa and Vitalia. Selenium you get with vitamin E. Omega Guard, it's always, you're going to see it tonight in everything I'm going to talk about, the omega-3 fatty acids. Omega-3 fatty acid is very important in everything. We had a whole lecture about it a year ago, so you just have to get the DVD for that if you want to know about omega-3. It's a wonderful product. The question, how much? Because what was happening here when I used to give lectures, and I tell the people, don't tell the people how much to take, then they either call me and I cannot sleep night, or they become patients, which I don't need them, because they can solve the problem themselves. So tonight we're telling you the amount you should take, so you don't make an appointment. The Omega Guard, it's 4 a day is minimum. You can go up to 15 a day. It depends what problem we're going to be dealing with tonight. The GLA is also very important. you don't take more than two, that's enough. But be generous with the omega, always. Performance is very important. The Shakti have a drink called Performance, very important for muscles. And it helps to feed the muscles with minerals. And the last thing, though, you have something called Citra Boost. Shakti makes this really excellent for muscle and for tension headache. Now, beside that, we have other things like we can do like meditation or prayers. That's very good for tension headache. It relaxes you because it secretes lots of interferon inside the body. Acupuncture, it sometimes works if the tension headache is really bad. And then herbal medicine. Aroma medicine has been proven to be good, like peppermint, eucalyptus, lavender. All of these have a tendency to relax if you put it in a candle, of course, you're going to smell the candle smoke all night. But if you have it in perfume or have somebody buy the perfume for you but have it in cologne, then you can smell it yourself on the sheets and then you feel. They said if you spray a little lavender on the pillow, just a little bit, when you sleep, you will have better sleep. This has been done, proven scientifically, by the way. Manual therapy, if you have to go to a chiropractor, you can go to a chiropractor. They do a very good job taking care of these problems also. Now we are finished with the first subject, which I'm glad because that makes me feel better. There's some more stuff about tension headache I didn't talk about. Okay, we'll put it right there. Exercise, walking, jogging, gardening, swimming, we already talked about that. Emotional treatment, have a positive attitude, and people who have tension headache usually unhappy, and you should try to surround yourself with the people that make you happy rather than the people make you unhappy. So you got to evaluate your life every single day then. Second one after that is migraine. And I explain to you why I'm going so fast. Because when we give a lecture, Alzheimer, I promised to cover multiple sclerosis. There was no time. So tonight, I like to put everything on the DVD first. Then we can have more time to ask questions, do all that in the very end. Well, migraine, before I talk about that, I wanted to show you what the... I want to show you what happens when the brain gets the blood. We bring that brain back right here. And let's see what happens when the brain gets the blood. That's normal person like you and me. Now you get an artery going in like that to the brain, coming from the heart. With the pressure pumping of what? 120 over 70. You know that, right? That's the blood pressure. 120 systolic, 70 diastolic. And that's enough pressure to put the blood all the way to the head. In cases of the head is so far away, like in giraffe, the pressure has to be three times as much, four times as much to push it up there. This is why giraffe, if they lay down, they will have a stroke because they have to stay up, and the camels, because they cannot take the pressure inside their head. So they stay up like that. We have 120 over 70 is fine with us. Now, what happened if we, in migraine, the artery itself, which it looks like this, that's what the artery looks like. That's a little artery right there. It has cells in it like that. Why does the artery have so many cells? How many layers? Why does the artery have so many layers? Because you don't want it to break, right? You can imagine a hose with a pressure 120 over 70, 120 pounds per square inch, and then you don't make it right, will blow up, right or wrong? This is what happens, aneurysm and strokes and things like that. These arteries right here supply the blood to the brain, 120 over 70. They contract and pulse like this and pumping blood. In patients who have an autoimmune disease, like fibromyalgia, chronic fatigue syndrome, they have something called migraine headache. What happened in migraine headache? Basically what happened, the artery itself, the first thing the artery get exposed to something, attack it. Migraine always have trigger, either visual trigger or noise or smell or perfume or something trigger the migraine. You follow me or no? The body, the man and a woman both gets smell the same thing or exposed to the same stress. For men, they will not react to the problem as women do. Women have to carry a child for 9 months and have to protect him. So she is more sensitive to any change in environment. Heat, cold, noise, stress, pressure in the air up and down, anything you can imagine they are. They have a hormones in the body that, like adrenal hormone, and they have estrogen, and they have progesterone, and those hormones tell the artery here that this person, you, being exposed to some kind of stress, chemical or environmental or nutrition deficiency. The artery, when it senses that, look what happened. The artery will look like this. It will close in like that. This is what the artery looks like. What do you see in here, right here? You see what? What happened? Constriction, spasm. The brain is not getting any oxygen. It's not getting any food. What the brain will do? First thing, the aura. The person who have migraine will feel something is not right. So you hear a woman will say something is not right, means she senses that in her brain. Something is not right. And most of doctors and men, they look at that as women try to complain or they try to get attention or try to do that, which in reality, it is happening in the children too. Little girls, once they get their period at age of 10 or 11, they start getting migraine headaches also because part of it is inherited. So once this happens, the brain has no oxygen. It has 5 minutes to get oxygen, otherwise it will die, right? So the brain panics, and immediately the brain will send a message to the adrenal gland back here till the adrenal gland secrete more adrenaline. So the adrenaline comes out, opens the artery by force. In the meantime, the pressure here is almost zero. So during that time, if it is 1 minute or 2 minutes or 30 seconds, there is every migraine attack, there is approximately 1 million brain cells will die for every attack. So it is so important to prevent migraine from happening. And thank God that you have 200 billion left. But still, if it goes on and on and on and on all your life, it will come a stage in your life you're going to lose function of that brain. Either you develop MS, or you develop memory loss, or you develop dementia. And you know dementia, Alzheimer, is 80% in women, 20% in men. So you have to know that it has a relationship to do with hormones. The adrenal gland comes in, and then immediately the artery looks like this. Like that. What's the difference between number A and number B? Number A has a pressure inside it of close to zero. Number B has pressure inside the brain close to 240 over 160. Where in the heart and the arm is still 120 over 70. But in the brain is 240 over. So you get that throbbing headache. You felt it, right? Lots of you felt that? Throbbing because the brain is trying to tell you help me out. You go away from the noise, you go away from the light, you put cold things, you do this, you're trying to do. But actually, it's an autoimmune disease. The urine, this stage where the headache goes on for 3-4 days, you don't lose brain cells. You lose it in the beginning. But if one of those rupture, or they could, you can develop mini strokes. You follow me or no? So it is so important for the doctor who's treating migraine patient to understand he must control step number A by preventing spasm, and we do that by encouraging them to have some caffeine or green tea or something to open the to prevent the spasm. Green tea will do that. Coffee will do that. And this is why you see migraine patients, they love coffee because it relaxes the artery. Then the doctor also has to prevent the pressure from going to 240. Are you following me or no? And you do that, if you're not going to use nutrition, use at least medication like Inderal or propranolol, atenolol, or anything to lower the blood pressure, because I don't care about the side effect of the drug. I care about not to have a stroke. Are you following me? As an internist, I'm a cardiologist. If you come to me with migraine, I'm going to stop it. And everywhere I'm going to stop it right away, because I don't know when it's going to blow up. But in the meantime, we wanted to talk about the things that important about migraine. The low migraine headache, then, it is caused by the spasm we talked about, autoimmune disease. During that time when the artery clogs like this, the platelets get clogged together. So there is a risk of stroke from the platelets making a blood clot. When the platelet do that, then the serotonin level drops down. When the serotonin level drops down, there is some degree of depression accompanied migraine headache. This is why Paxil, Prozac, and Zoloft, and all the serotonin antagonists, they work, because they do help the serotonin level. But we cannot depend on those alone. We have to do other things. Another thing in a migraine headache or tension headache, both of them, you have too much histamine. What does histamine do when you have histamine? I'm going to give you an example. A bee sting in your arm bring histamine to the area. What do you see in the area? Swelling, right? That's what's histamine. The pain causes swelling of the muscle. Pain causes swelling of the nerve. Pain causes swelling of the brain, swelling of the artery. So it is not a bad idea to consider antihistamine sometimes when you have those attacks. That's not in the medical book. That's my discovery, and I used it with patients. Has not been published. Many patients who have migraine headache, they have valve disease in their heart, valvular disease, mitral valve prolapse. And those patients, when they have mitral valve prolapse, they can have cardiac arrhythmia and things like that, and we should be able to control that easy. Migraine headache, again, how do you differentiate between tension headache and migraine headache? Usually migraine is one side, starts on one side of the face before it goes to the other side. It's unilateral. Usually you can see scotoma, lights in front of you. You know it's coming. Migraine, it has a genetic component, but in many times what we have found out that having so much free radicals in the air or the water or food precipitate migraine attacks. Everybody here knows what a free radical is? Anybody doesn't know what free radical is? Neither way? Okay. Free radical is basically the bad stuff in the air or water or food that kill us. That's what we call it, free radical. So in case of free radical, your body is prepared to handle free radical. If that person next to me smoking a cigarette in an airplane or the airport, I'm not going to go and have a fight with him. No, I will just take extra antioxidant to counter his problems that he's given me. Or, like Austin Moyle, I don't know if he's still alive or not. He's I don't know if you remember Moyle in Boise, Idaho. I think he was 85, 90 degrees or something about 20 years ago. But one time he took me to the airport. We were sitting together, until I get on the plane, and he next to him there was this young lady smoking. And he looked at her and said, tell her, well, if you don't blow smoke in my face, I will not spit in your coffee. And I said, only a man with 80-something can say that. If I said it, I will have a slap. But anyway, smoking also can precipitate migraine headache. Lots of smoking can come from your work area that you bring it home with you, that somebody's smoking. And then if you are a policeman, a fireman, an inspector, or somebody goes in homes, you taking all the stuff in your clothes, and it's better to have a place, a house, to take that, like doctors we do. Well, once we enter the house, we take all the clothes off, and then that had germs, it has smell to it, it has all that stuff from chemicals, and then we dress with something more appropriate. That is good. Also, sleep problem. Most of migraine patients have a sleep disturbance. Most of them have chronic fatigue also. And they do have also, lots of them have allergies, and they are sensitive to eating too much. If they eat so much cheese with all the additives, they can precipitate migraine attacks. They will find out they have very low magnesium, and they take too much aspirin, too much Tylenols, so the withdrawal. Migraine attack can be affected by the barometer pressure. If the pressure, if it's going to rain or it's not going to rain, it can bring migraine attack to that patient. Candidiasis can also aggravate it, and anxiety and depression can cause migraine, and stress also can cause migraine. This is the stuff that I don't want you to know. But the stuff I want you to know is what we're going to talk about, nutrition for migraine. And that is something you really should pay attention to. Migraine patients have very low unsaturated fatty acids. They have very low omega-3. They are. All of them have very low. So if they switch to oil in the salad, and oil in cooking with lots of oil in cooking, like 50 grams a day, in cooking, that oil is unsaturated. If it's mazola or olive or canola or flaxseed, they have some better than others, but they all still better than margarine or saturated fat. You follow me or no? So another thing you have to understand that using oil in cooking and using oil in the salad, oil itself is anti-blood clots. So not only omega-3 is anti-blood clots, oil itself prevents blood clots. Onion prevents blood clots. And onion also has been shown to help against migraine attacks. Not to smell it, I'm talking about to eat it. You can do both. Garlic also be known to thin the blood and prevents platelet aggregation, prevents a stroke also. Omega-3, we already talked about that. And the antioxidant, let's go through the antioxidant. Beta-carotene is number one for migraine patients, beta-carotene. They should consume about 4 to 6 a day of that. So you can see the difference between tension have different dose, migraine have a different dose. And that's my job as a doctor, to tell the patient what to take and what problem. Vitamin E, the 800 units a day is minimum, but you can go to 1600 units if you have a migraine. C is also very good against migraine. You can be generous with the vitamin C when you have a migraine attack. Go to 3,000 milligrams, not 500 milligrams a day. Vitamin B2, you get that from the B complex, 400 milligrams a day for 3 months. That means 8B complex a day for 3 months. Then after that, you cut it down to 2 or 4 a day when the attack's no longer coming. In our clinic, we have given magnesium in high dosage to patients who have migraine, unless they have intestinal problem. But they can't take enough magnesium to prevent migraine because they have diarrhea. So we give them magnesium intravenously. Over 10 minutes or 20 minutes, we put lots of magnesium in the bottle and run it through, and the migraine, 90% of it will disappear without drugs. I just want to show you the miracle of God and earth, magnesium, potassium. All of this we have around us, we don't even use it. But we are good at taking drugs. So with magnesium, you have to be generous with it according to how much your intestine can tolerate. When you have the attacks, don't take about 6 at one time because you're going to have diarrhea. Just take 1-3 times a day when you have the attack. If you want to increase it 2-3 times a day, I don't know if you can tolerate that or not. You probably will have diarrhea, but you can increase to 4 a day without a problem. Omega Guard, omega-3, for patients with, during the attack of migraine, you need 14 grams a day during the attack. 14 grams a day, that means that's all you do all day is eat omega-3. You know, that means about almost 14 to 20 capsules a day. But I want you to, before you start getting scared about fish oil and all of that, let's look at the other side. You're going to have a stroke. You're having problems. The doctor's going to give you kefir gut or give you all this medication that can have side effects to it. And this is the fish oil, you know. So actually, fish oil is a better choice than some of these drugs. GLA is also good with that, 2 a day. Melatonin has been shown to help migraine also. The herbs, ginger, is being known to help against migraine. And ginger helps the stomach, you know, aches in stomach. You probably had some of it yourself in your life. It's also help if you can take 500 milligrams 4 times a day of ginger roots or ginger capsules. That also help that. There are things not researched yet, but it is in holistic medicine we use. Intranasal pepper capsicum, you know, the spray of pepper. Not too strong, you dilute it so much, and then you inhale it. It a little bit irritates the nasal sinus. When it does that, somehow the brain thinks the nose is going to fly away, and then he let the migraine go to concentrate in the nose. So that is a very good way to fool the brain. They said, okay, you know. Okay. Let's see if anything else left with that about migraine. No. We covered migraine already, and we will take questions in the end. And I'm not going to look at my watch yet because I'd be stressed. So we're going to talk about multiple sclerosis. I already talked about multiple sclerosis before in the beginning. I said 200 billion nerves coming down, and those nerves, they look like this again. I'm going to draw the picture again of the cell, the mother, the stem and the tail. Remember those. And you remember what we said? It has insulation of what we call it what? Myelin. The myelin sheath. So we all agree on that. We all agree that multiple sclerosis patient, when we look at their brain, it does not look normal. It looks like it has a sludge built inside their brain. Let us look at normal brain first, what it looks like. Like supposedly we have one here today. We will see that those cells surrounded by how many cells to correct the problem. You remember from the beginning we said that, 10,000. Remember that? We said that. So actually, the brain doesn't have to worry about multiple sclerosis or migraine or all that. It has things to build itself, even for a stroke. And those helper cells, they're all the time. They don't die. The brain cells will die, but this will never die. And they can get involved and make a new brain cell. And they will make a new brain cell. And we have pictures showing you. I think you remember when I talked about the estrogen loss. It can cause Alzheimer. And I showed you a picture of the brain before and after the lady took the estrogen and before. And here she had a new brain cells were developing in the picture from the autopsy. I showed it in one of the lectures. So in multiple sclerosis, what happened then? We don't know the cause of it, but we know there's nobody have succeeded of curing it. But I know that my patient, I have one patient have it now for 34 years, and she's still working. I have another patients have it for the same amount, and they almost were in a wheelchair, close to a wheelchair, and they're still walking. But in multiple sclerosis, there are setbacks. It can go dormant, come back again. So for those patients who I have for 35 years, I believe nutrition did help them, because they function, work 40 hours a week or 50 hours a week, 60 hours a week. They're doing fine. And these are female patients who have multiple sclerosis. So it can be done. Are we going to be building the myelin sheath back? Maybe. Are we going to be building new cells back? Maybe. We know that multiple sclerosis is an autoimmune disease, that when the body attacks itself. Remember that we put that picture in the beginning. So in multiple sclerosis, the body is attacking what? The brain cells. And then the way we counter that attack is we have to be smarter in many ways, especially in nutrition. Okay. Multiple sclerosis, as I mentioned here, is very similar to Lugaric disease, is similar to cerebral palsy, is similar to ALS. And you know, ALS is a killer disease. So I think if we pay more attention to the autoimmune disease effect on the brain and MS patients and ALS patients and that, and then I would not be surprised also that ADD and ADHD children will end up by having some of those neurological diseases later on, because we have identified abnormalities in their brain, but we also have reversed it, you know, in them using omega-3 and other things. So multiple sclerosis is basically the brain gets degenerated, the myelin sheath gets disappeared. It does affect everything. It affects the motor function. There's a problem of walking. You will feel like you can walk. How do you know you're going to have it or not? Watch the walking, how you walk. Are you getting clumsy in your walking? You hit an object and you drop in things. That is beginning sign there's something wrong. It might not show in the MRI scan or PET scan yet, but this could be the beginning. And by giving the proper nutrition, we might reverse it without you even know you had it. You follow me or no? Okay. So in the motor, they become clumsy and they rough things out. In sensory, patients, usually women, some men too, they will have numbness and tingling in hands or fingers or feet, and those things right here persistent, and it gets worse. If numbness, like if you hit your elbow, you slipped on your arm at night like this, that's normal to have numbness. If you block the circulation all night from your arm, you're gonna be numb. But if you normal and then you feel numbness, that's not normal. The balance, multiple sclerosis, they start having lightheadedness. and dizziness and vertigo and ataxia. They have lots of that. Visual, they start have blur vision, blind spots, double vision, haziness. And then when we do nerve conduction studies and MRI scan, we can see some of the problems. We don't have to do spinal fluid anymore. Why do we see it more in the north pole and the south pole, but we don't see it in the middle? When you get to the middle of the earth, you don't see much multiple sclerosis at all. If you go north to the Norway and all this place, and the south, they have 40 times as much multiple sclerosis as the one by the equator. We don't know because I don't think it's related to the light, because they get lights and the Eskimos don't have multiple sclerosis and they have the same thing. So we think it might have something to do that these patients, they have tendency not to tolerate cold very well, and the circulation closes on the arteries and they don't get enough circulation, and maybe that's the reason they develop damage to the nerves. High altitude also. People live in Colorado in high altitude have 20 times more multiple sclerosis than the people live in the desert. So why high altitude? Maybe oxygen have something to do with that. We don't know lots of this. This is all the statistics I'm giving you right now. It is more in women than men, 3 to 2, usually between age of 20 to age 40. And the causes of it, we don't know. Viral infections, I have seen some of my patients have Epstein-Barr virus, cytomegaly viruses, and then when we see it, we treat it with immune globulins, with nutrition also. We have also noticed that they have abnormal digestion. Multiple sclerosis patients have also very sensitive to salads and vegetables, and they get bloated or they have diarrhea. They don't tolerate things very well, and Optiflora can be a very big help for that. We noticed that all MS patients have decreased omega-3 in their system, and also they have too much saturated fatty acids, the margarine we talked about, and they have too much prostaglandin, which I don't want to get involved in that. Basically, prostaglandin is the substance that gives you pain. So they have lots of pain, but they don't feel the pain because the nerve is dead. But the pain is there. So we can counter that with anti-pain things like boswellia, alfalfa, calcium, magnesium, all the stuff we're going to talk about. We can counter the pain with those. We don't have to ignore it. We think multiple sclerosis might have something to do with environmental toxins, chemicals, heavy metals, mercury filling or mercury in the environment. Lots of our patients, we detoxify every single patient who come to us. We remove the heavy metals from their body when we treat them, and they seem to do very well when we do that. We notice that lots of MS patients have vitamin D deficiency. So you can say that, yeah, you can. We can give them extra calcium with vitamin D. We talked about that earlier. They're very sensitive to stress. There is a study, it's like a miracle study was done, and it's shown that when we give multiple sclerosis patients intravenous immune globulin, I have it right here someplace, but we're not going to have the time to go over it. Immune globulin is a substance in your body that make you fight infections, fight cancer, fight disease, called immune globulin, the immunity system, okay? For some reason, when this patient received 30 grams immune globulin, remember that cost $140 a gram, 30 gram every day for 5 days. So you can calculate all the thousands of dollars going to cost. When they received 30 grams every day for 5 days, followed by 30 grams every other month for a year, 70% got cured of the of those. So you're dealing with really, really something the government should put in efforts, because that's $80,000 or $100,000 in 1 year. But what's $100,000 in 1 year if you can help that person the rest of their life? 70%, the statistics have been shown right here. I have it down here, down there. 20 to 30 grams. I put it down there so you can see it. 20 to 30 grams are intravenous. In our patients, they can afford that. So what we do, we give them 2 grams, 3 grams, 1 gram when they have those viruses. That's, we stick with that, 140, 280, or 400. We stick with that. We have good results. And those patients I have, they have good results. We did good with 5 grams, 6 grams a month for the last 30 years. But they have to pay it themselves every month. But they're happy with it that way. But the study shows 6 grams is not enough. It's 30 grams. So if you take, I'm giving 60 grams to that patient every month for 30 years, maybe giving 30 grams a day for 5 days, and then every other month for a year, that's better choice. But insurance company, they're suppressing this effort. But I bet you if we challenge them in court, they will lose, because this study being published and proved to be accepted by the FDA. They use instead interferon injections. Interferon have so many side effects. And it is true, when you give interferon, there is 30% improvement, but there is 70% improvement with immune globulin. So if you have interferon and you have the gamma globulin, you might have 100%. Are you following me or no? This is our statistics being published about it. And let us talk about the holistic treatment for multiple sclerosis. Again, we have noticed that those patients have too much saturated fatty acids in their diet. They eat too much McDonald's, they eat too much Burger King, they eat too much saturated fat, they eat too much junk food. We're not saying that caused it. We're saying we notice that they have that in their body. We tell them, switch to reasonable thing with oil in it, you know, rather than lard and fat and animal fat. Because that is something that's been studied already, that they do have too much saturated fatty acids. Saturated fatty acids basically can cause every disease. We have also noticed if they increase, just like the other people with migraine, their intake of oil to 50 grams a day, they also improve faster. When they take 12 grams of omega-3 a day, they also improve faster. When they took soy protein and eat fish, and lots of fish, and they have lots of, they can have beef and turkey and all that stuff, no problem, but fish is becoming number one for them. They also tend to improve faster. Supplements-wise, again, we're going to go over it for the patients here who have multiple sclerosis. Omega-3, you need 6 capsules 3 times a day. That's 18. GLA, you need 2 twice a day. Flaxseed oil should be part of your diet. Vitamin E should be 1,200 units a day. Lecithin should be 6 to 10 a day. Vitalia, 6 to 8 a day. B12, by injection only. That is the only difference. B12 does not work under the tongue or by mouth in most of these cases. By injection, the recommendation of our American Board of Holistic Medicine was 10,000 milligrams daily, and that is huge amount. We only recommending to the patient to take 1,000 milligrams twice a week, and they still do better. So B12 has been shown to help. But don't take the B12 under the tongue and you think you're going to absorb it. Believe it or not, don't fool yourself. If you're taking that stuff, Shaklee, B12, and the Vitalis is fine. But don't just go out and get the stuff under the tongue and all this. It doesn't work. You need cyanocobalamin, and you, if you have multiple sclerosis, you're not going to be taking enough Vitalia. This is why we are increasing the B12 injection. We can make the injections of multiple sclerosis patients in our office and mail it to them without them coming to see us. You don't have to come and say, just call, say, I want B12. We make our B12 different. It has B1 and 2 and 3 and 5 and 6 and folic acid and 12 together, which is very, very important. If you have mercury in your teeth and you have a mass, you should get it out. If you are, you should be checked for lead toxicity. You should have hair analysis. See if you have lead in your hair or not. Everybody heard about hair analysis? Why we don't do brain analysis? Because you don't want to biopsy the brain. All right? So we do the hair because we always can grow hair. And the hair is just like archaeological site. It tells you the history of your body. Right there is printed inside that hair. When it grows like the nails, we can detect how is the body doing for 6 months or a year or something like that. We cut the hair usually from the scalp, few strands, all the way to the end, give it to the chemist, they grind it, and they check for lead for us for the last 2-3 years because that hair has been around for that long. Exercise helps multiple sclerosis patient. Nutrafurin has been, it probably will help these patients if they take 6 a day. Alfalfa probably will help them also. Pain relief complex that you have from Boswellia, that's the LOX inhibitor that you have in your company, Shaklee have it in their catalog, is also is anti what? Inflammatory, and we're talking about inflammation all along tonight, so don't forget that. We have used adrenal extract injections to our patients. We give them ACTH injection, or we can give them steroids, but we prefer giving them ACTH over steroids. And they do have, some people have used bee venom. They get the bee like this and let the venom go in their arm, and it does stimulate the nerve, but that's not the treatment I like to do. MS patients, they have lots of mental and emotional problems because they were not given hope to enjoy life. And this lecture intended to tell them, yes, you have hope to enjoy your life because there is a cure for your problem. Now we're going to be talking about, I can look at the watch now, attention deficit disorder. I didn't think I'm going to get to that one at all. Attention deficit disorder is one of those diseases that me and Joyce in the back, we've been talking about it probably since King Tut was there, and we had not found anybody listening to any what we say. We said nutrition. They said, no, nutrition doesn't work. Ritalin works. We said this and this and this. We lost. However, now the latest research is in front of you to show you it's a real disease. And the treatment is not Ritalin. Attention deficit disorder is a child that is hyperactive, and he is distractible. He doesn't have attention span. He have short attention span, actually. He doesn't listen. He have poor concentration. That is symptom of a disease of the brain. Okay, that child have. He's not making it up. He doesn't want to upset you. He doesn't want to upset the teacher. He doesn't want to upset nobody, but he is helpless. He have that. Are you following me or no? However, attention deficit hyperactive disorder is a little bit worse. They're impulsive. They can act before they think. They can hit you without thinking they hit you. Are you following me or not? You got to treat the children like that, as a children, and don't become like punishable. If you do this, I'm going to do that to you. Because many of the time, they don't know they're doing that. Are you following me or no? Like seizure. Have you ever seen seizure patients? Seizure. Do you think he's controlling his hand if he bites you or anything? He's not. He doesn't know, right or wrong. Hyperactive children the same way. They need to understand they are normal in every way, and they have some brain disorder that we can correct using nutrition and things. And Ritalin will not correct it. You know what Ritalin is? Amphetamine. Amphetamine is an illegal drug. But I have a license to prescribe it to you. But it's not going to do you any good. Amphetamine is very highly addictive. It's bad for the heart. It's bad for the brain. It's bad. Would you feel good when you take it? Absolutely. You take Ritalin, you feel like a million. You take cocaine, also you feel like a million. So we have to be careful. If the child needs Ritalin, yes, okay, we're going to give him the Ritalin in the 3 hours of school or 5 hours only, but not the rest of the day. And also we're going to implement other nutritional things for him right away. He is usually act before he thinks. Sudden shift in activity. Will be doing something, switch to something else right away, and go back. He cannot stay in one place, moves all the time. He cannot be quiet. He wants to talk. But when you challenge him in a game, give him something to play with him, immediately he gets involved playing with you in a game. He will not, but he loves to be attended to. Are you following me or no? So I want you to just understand this, because if you had a child, you're lucky. Many people spend thousands of dollars, they cannot have a children. So you should take care of them. Even if they have Down syndrome, even if they have whatever, you have to love them more than you love your pets. I think most of people treat their cats and dogs better than treat handicapped children. And that's not nice, because you made them, God made them, and they're beautiful their own ways, you know? So this is, I raised a handicapped child when I finished Cairo University. The doctor came to my uncle, Supreme Justice, and he said, your son is going to die within 2-3 days because he has one eye, one little heart. But the boy didn't die. And I finished Cairo University, and my uncle, I was visiting, and I noticed that I went to the bathroom, and the mother was trying to drown him in the bathtub. So I said, what are you doing? She said, I'm washing him. It wasn't washing him. It was drowning to me. So I got him out. I grabbed him. I dried him up and things like that. And then when my uncle came, I told him, your wife was trying to kill your son. And they divorced that night. It was not even next night. Because you do that to your son, then you can do that to anybody. You follow me or not? Then I end up by moving with him, because all the maids, they don't give him the vitamins. They don't give him food. They don't clean him. They don't this. Then I was taking care of this. I never had a child, and then I didn't know what's a crib, so I have him sleep with me in bed, but I didn't know about diapers, so I wake up covered with a stool all over me, but you know, I was a biochemist, so I was sort of professor in university. I don't judge actions like that to children at all, so I just take, and then when you look at him with all the stuff, he looked with one eye with a smile. Just very faint a smile. Then I grab him and we go to the shower, we take a bath together and all of that stuff, and then I give him to the maid, and then I go to work, I come back. We did that for 6 years. Until one day I discovered the crib later on. I put him in the crib, but he went like this and he wouldn't let me sleep. So one day he came to the bed. We were 2 o'clock in the afternoon. My uncle came from court and he was taking a nap after a Supreme Justice hearing. And then in the hot desert, you always take a siesta because it gets so hot that you have to sleep a little bit. Then he was sleeping next to me, and then all of a sudden, he banging on the balcony. And then I opened, maybe he wanted to play in the balcony. Then the balcony, he went to there, and he banged on his dad's balcony from the outside. Then I opened my uncle's balcony, but he was asleep. I didn't want to wake him up. He opened up. He walked to his dad, climbed the bed, slept next to him. By 6 o'clock, he was dead. So we buried him that night. Me and my uncle, we carried him to the grave, and we buried him together. And we are the only two people in the family knew about it. You know, so in a way, those children are very, very important to take care of. They didn't talk too much. They interrupt you. They have coordination problems, speech and hearing disorders. And they usually have abnormal PET scan in their brain. So if you have a child with ADHD, you should insist on a PET scan of the brain. Be sure that the brain doesn't have a lesion in it or something. Check their hormones. Check the heavy metals. Lots of them have heavy metals. Check their blood test. And then usually we find something in their prefrontal lobe, in the front. And then the next page, what can we do for them? And that is that one right here. Okay, what caused it? What caused it? It could be genetic. It can be environmental. Mother could be drinking alcohol or taking cocaine, drugs, nicotine, heavy metals. He could have birth hypoxia when he was born. The cord might have got tied a little bit longer than it should. Are you following me or no? Because the baby doesn't know any of that stuff, and you don't know either. So I'm telling you the possibilities right there. We have identified they are usually low birth weight. Their EEG, it has abnormalities similar to seizure. They have theta waves in it. When we check their adrenal gland, they have low adrenaline, so maybe DHEA will be helpful to them. They do have hypoglycemia very easy. They get low blood sugar very, very easy. So it's better to give them frequent meals during the day. They get lots of ear infections. You pay attention to Benadryl at night so you keep the ear unclogged. They do have nutritional deficiencies, as you can see right here. We find out lots of them have low iron. So we will suggest giving them an extra iron, and I will tell you the supplement in the down here. So I'm going to give you the amount in the very end, so you don't have to write everything. They have deficiency of vitamin C, B1, B3, B5, B6, and bioflavonoids. They have a problem with fatty acid metabolism. So don't give them saturated fats, hamburgers, and stuff like that. They do very well on unsaturated, like olive oils and oils. And now how are you going to cook an egg in oil for a kid that likes butter or likes margarine? Believe me, if you put oil in a pan and you cook the egg, you wouldn't even know the difference between oil and a butter. They taste almost the same. If you don't burn it, they taste the same. What else do they have deficient? Yeah, they have, since birth, we discovered they have very low omega-3. So it could be the mother have not taken enough omega-3 when she was pregnant. Because the brain is 70% omega-3, the eye is 90% omega-3, and the skin and the rest of the body is 40% omega-3. So you know the brain lives on omega-3. They tend to be aggravated very easy by white sugar, or white flour and sugar, and ice cream and chocolate. They have a craving for it. And you have to figure a way to give them juices and apples and fruits and things like that to suppress that desire for sugar. Because they have hypoglycemia. And you know the brain, I said in the beginning, 70% of the sugar goes to the brain. So don't ask anybody who eats chocolate or crave sweets why. Because the brain said so. Are you following me or not? And you must give the sugar to the brain. But you got the choices. If you get an apple and be patient before you jump on the ice cream on that, maybe you do a good job and you get the satisfaction. For the kid, the same thing. Send some fruits with them to school and have them take it several times a day. We have also noticed something that was in the news last night or this morning, no, last night, that finally they admitted food additives can contribute to attention deficit disorder. Last night on TV, I heard it in the news. Well, they get exposed to lots of BHA, BHT, bleach, coloring, flavoring, emulsifiers, fillers, thickeners. The child consume, and every American consume, 10 pounds of food additives every year. Every one of us, 10 pounds we get every year. The more you careful you are, you probably get 1 pound. But eventually, we all get something. This is why the supplement is coming here. It's very important. What supplement we can give this patient with ADD or ADHD? Supplement-wise, iron. 20 to 100 milligrams of iron a day. So you can calculate. One shekel of iron have 18. So you can give one or two or three and do a blood test to check the iron. Vitamin C, 1,000 milligrams of vitamin C, also very good for them. A day, one time. But listen careful. When we come to the B complex, it's not going to be once a day. Vitamin B has to be given 3 times a day. B1, I have to break it down for you. B1, thiamine, 100 milligrams, 3 times a day. B6, 100 milligrams, 3 times a day. B3, 500 milligrams twice a day. And you know, if you take a niacin by itself, see how you feel with the heat it gives you. So it's better to take the B in form of what? B complex. Because if you separate them, they're just so uncomfortable to the skin. Even we do give niacin to certain patients with Alzheimer and cholesterol and that, still the child will be uncomfortable. So the pantothenic acid, about 400 milligrams twice a day. Bioflavonoids. Even bioflavonoids, which I did my PhD on it, bioflavonoids, that's the white stuff you get in oranges, the white meat in orange. So when you see an orange, the yellow stuff is what? Beta carotene, right? Everything underneath it white is bioflavonoids. So if you can adapt a way that you can remove the bitterness from the peel by scraping it or by squeezing like a bunch of grapefruits, lots of when they're on sale, and throw the juice away, and then the rest what's left with the seeds, put it in the oven and let it dry and make a powder out of it, you made your own bioflavonoids. The child needs about 1,000 milligrams a day. That's about a teaspoon a day. And you can mix it with salad or soup or anything. It doesn't have any taste to it. Tryptophan, some does help them. Diphenylalanine also helps them, 1,500 milligrams a day. Tyrosine also helps them. You get that from the soy protein. And you get tyrosine in the cinch diet that we're going to be talking about next time. It has quite a bit of it, 1,500 milligrams twice a day. You have to eliminate food additives and sugar in their diet. They respond very well, these kids, to lots of lights in the room. Lots of stimulant light, no darkness. So when they are awake, gets extra light when they're doing homework, because it stimulates vitamin D, it seems stimulates the brain, they think better. So these are the things that the school doesn't do. Physical challenge, they love challenge. You don't underestimate them. You give them, tell them, I want you to build that house. He will try to build it. They have lots of energy and they want to please you. So we have finished with the lecture on everything we want to talk about today. And I think I'm supposed to talk about a couple things. Joyce raised her hands, and this means I missed something. There's somebody who have cerebral palsy. That's what you want to ask about?
No, you didn't mention omega-3.
I said omega-3, omega-guard, that's what it is. Omega guard, all omegas, I said all through the lecture, the 13 gram, the 18 gram, the 6 gram, it's all omegas. And the DVD will show that over there. So anyway, I would like to tell you that people who have muscular dystrophy, ALS, cerebral palsy, they treat it exactly like multiple sclerosis patient, the same management. The diet, next time, we're going to be talking about why do we gain weight, why the weight around the waist, and what to do about it, because The weight in the shoulder and in other areas don't hurt you. The weight around the waist is the one we're going to talk about. It's going to be talking about the diet and how can you control that. How can you lose some inches and then help your circulation? And that's going to be on October 25th. I will take some questions, but thank you very much. Thanks. Oh no, we don't have any study on that, and that specific. I only give tonight what's been published. But Omega Guard, I would say about similar to other, maybe about 4 grams a day. But there was no paper being done on it yet. That's the reason I didn't say it. For ADHD, there's no scientific paper on it yet. Oh, they did a study, but there was not a double-blind studies and lots of children, and it was not the study we have shown today in our vitamin C and B and all of this stuff. These are done on 100,000 or 50,000 kids. So when you have a study on one or two kids, you cannot really tell. Omega for everybody. I said in the beginning, anybody who have a brain disorder need omega. And I mentioned to you also when we do a PET scan, and this we discover abnormalities in the frontal lobe, similar to one we see in Alzheimer in those children. So it is very important to give omega. But Alzheimer and MS patients and multiple sclerosis, remember I said 13 to 18 grams a day. So a child is not going to have 18 grams a day because it's going to be difficult for them, but at least 4 or 5 grams will be fine. Okay, we'll take some questions from front to the back. Okay, no question here. I'm not coming backward, but going that way. Okay, I'm going to tell you something. For any of you who have to rush to the bathroom or you need to go for any reason, I left some of my cards outside. I'm going to put my phone number right here, 847-356-9009. That's my office. That if you want to make an appointment, we have 3-month waiting list. If you wish to come in, you have to talk to me in person, and I will figure a way to stay late to see you. For questions, my cellular phone is 847-571-3914. But if it's urgent and you have to get in, you have to tell the secretary that Dr. Nasser want to fit me as soon as possible. And if we have cancellation, we fit you in. If not, I'm going to stay until 7 or 8 o'clock at night to see you then. Okay? Or I'll see you on the weekend. Any questions here? Yes, sir.
The lady I talked to said that her doctor said that the MS is an autoimmune disease, and so she was concerned about the neutrofuran, which would help the immune system, and afraid that that would overdo it and cause more problems.
Well, just think about it. They give him interferon. Neutrofuran is interferon. So they're giving them interferon anyway. So I don't think the doctor knows what neutrofuran is. Because actually, in reality, it's a bunch of vegetables and mushrooms connected that they have things to boost the immune system. It doesn't work against lupus. It doesn't work against MS. It does help. But there's no scientific study to show at all. If anybody tell you that, tell them, show me the study that pumpkin seeds is contraindicated for MS. That's what the neutrofuran is made of. Show me in the study that mushroom shiitake is contraindicated in my MS. That's what's made of. Are you following me or not? There are 4 vegetables made in it, and you can tell the doctor, here it is. I had a doctor call me today. We have lots of doctors, but they know in my area I'm in holistic. We treat cancer patients, and when they get a patient, they call me. They said, we like you to adjust the dosage of vitamins. We like to work together if they're going to have radiation. Then we agree on program over the phone. You do this, I do that, you know. So he told me, well, don't let them use too much vitamin E before the therapy and this and that, and then we work together. Some doctors have open mind. If they're not open mind, just ignore it. Because whatever we said, it works, and that's the bottom line. Okay? Any other questions? Yes, ma'am.
Can you tell When you say that when you meet people that, like, you get rid of the metals in their system, what are you doing?
We use chelation to do that. We use chelation therapy to do that for them. Chelation is using EDTA intravenously to bound to the mercury or lead in their body and get it out. And they receive that between several times a year if they are exposed to too much. And it depends on the condition of the patient. But we do give it as a part of the methylation, so there is no extra charge for chelation. You know, that is methylation is something else we're not going to talk about tonight. Is the circulation problems, basically. We do that. Yes, ma'am.
And you said that the calcium works better with vitamin D. Is that better, right, with the calcium magnesium, or is that with the extra vitamin
D? Calcium work with vitamin D. Yeah, it does.
Where would you get that extra vitamin D from?
The Osteometrics has an excellent dose of vitamin D. It's perfect formula for vitamin D and calcium together. It's just much, much better than calcium magnesium before. Yes, ma'am.
You talk a lot about using olive oil and canola oil and that sort. How do you feel about coconut oil? We're hearing a lot about it.
There is nothing wrong with coconut oil. I don't think we should eat lots of it because there's not too many coconuts in the world. And besides, they said there is saturated fatty acid in it. That's what you tend. But, you know, the saturated fatty acid in coconuts is no different from the saturated fatty acid in butter. We know that the saturated fatty acid in butter doesn't give you clogged arteries where margarine does. So the butter is good for you. Whole milk is good for you. And milk full of fat is good for you. You know, it doesn't raise the cholesterol. It doesn't raise triglycerides. You know, I had an Amish girl. He had a lupus. And then I treated her, and she really felt so good from Missouri. And she wanted to give me a gift that day. She went, wake up, milk the cows in the morning, and she brought me 2 gallons. You know, fresh milk like I had in my village. I never hadn't seen that. So I'm going to have to go home and boil it. I don't want these germs to go in my mouth and all this stuff. Well, I'm sitting in the car. By the time I got home, I drank the whole gallon. And then I said, oh, my gosh, I'm probably going to have diarrhea. I'm probably going to vomit. Nothing happened. Apparently, when things are natural, your body accepts it. When they get sterilized and processed, maybe the body doesn't. So the regarding to the oil, the question about the oils, coconut oil is fine if you want to have it once in a while. Yeah. Yes, ma'am.
You didn't mention how chocolate affects migraines.
Chocolate improves migraine. Yes. It's like coffee. Yes. Anybody, you have a question right here? No, I'm going to go to the back. Yes, Nancy.
What about a person who was an older person in their 70s that has a stressed kidney? Should we be careful with the amounts of the supplements that we offer?
Anytime you have a stress level or kidney or intestine, you got to be careful with supplements because they are the organs that are going to process it. Any other questions? Yeah, just one question, please. Yes.
I've read news. It was talking about
I didn't hear the question. Can you say it louder, please? Or your mom, or she can say it louder for you.
I read it. Well, she was talking about the fillings, what is in the fillings of mercury. And
yes.
If it was on the news, should you have them removed or should you be concerned about
them? I don't think I would have them removed because by the time you have the mercury in your teeth already, it's already in the brain and all over the body and very little of it left in the teeth. Don't spend lots of time on that because there are some mercury still there, but lots of it is in the body already. So I would suggest if it's going to be easy job, 1 or 2 teeth to take them out and do it, yes. If not, I would just leave it and just take supplements. Yes, Marianne. That's fine. It's better to have it removed if you think, you know, it's good. But if you have had it, you have to remember some of that mercury is in the brain and the bones and need to be removed also by chelation. That's right. Any other question in this corner right here? Yes, in the back. Way in the back.
I don't have a question, but I just wanted to say that there has been studies done with ADD and ADHD children and their relationship to nature, the fact that we have gotten so far away from the natural world, and that when you take those children and put them in, there is a book called Last Child in the Woods, the Richard Groom, and he has done studies with children. Mm-hmm.
I think that's another point we just added to the lecture. If you remember the triangle we had in the past about nutrition, that if you have less stress, you will have better child, and the children who are grown in stress and nature, of course, have less stress, and that's probably will help. Any other question in the front right here? Yes, ma'am.
Go see a doctor tomorrow because I was just diagnosed with MS and we're talking about treatment options. Do you have all of this stuff written down in a format that's a little clearer than my scribble notes?
You got the DVD right there and you can get it and watch it. That's probably the best. But all this information we have here, all of it, we have the papers being published that proven it also. The problem is a neurologist practice his practice and give him medication and try to practice your practice without medication is not going to work. So like a heart surgeon, like when I used to be doing heart surgery, you know, we used to make $5,000 in 20 minutes. And when I quit, then I don't have that. I have one-tenth of what I used to make. But some people like to stay in their field that way. Some people to get out of that and go to another field. And that's what I did. Okay, thank you very much, and you have a good night.